Hello all, my name is Zohri Chaudhary and today's topic is about water treatment. Drinking water supplies in the United States are among the safest in the world. However, even in the US, drinking water sources can become contaminated, causing sickness and disease from waterborne pathogens. Drinking water sources are subject to contamination from chemical and biological agents and require appropriate treatment to remove these harmful disease-causing agents and chemicals. Public drinking water systems use various methods of water treatment in order to meet water quality safety standards set by the United States Environmental Protection Agency. Today, the most common steps in water treatment used by community water systems include 7 steps. However, not all of these steps are present in all plants. These steps are pretreatment, coagulation and flocculation, sedimentation, filtration, disinfection, supplemental treatment that sometimes is utilized in some plants, in others is not, and finally storage and distribution. In this diagram, we can see the 7 steps in more detail. For example, you can see the pretreatment in here, coagulation and flocculation in here, sedimentation, filtration, disinfection, supplemental treatment, and storage and distribution. So the first step in a water treatment process is pretreatment. Pretreatment is any physical, chemical, or mechanical process used on water before it undergoes the main treatment process. First, water is taken from a source with the help of an intake pipe. The pretreatment step greatly varies from treatment plant to treatment plant. The purpose is to remove materials which will interfere with further treatment. This includes screening, aeration, and pre-disinfection. So screening is any large debris is stopped from traveling into the intake pipe by coarse filters and bars. And aeration essentially is a treatment step that removes the water from the water, dissolved gases such as carbon dioxide and hydrogen sulfide, as well as dissolved metals such as iron and manganese, and converts these dissolved metals into their oxide form. And this pretreatment can also remove volatile organic compounds or VOCs. In addition, in the pretreatment, pre-disinfection sometimes is also utilized. In these cases, you can use chlorine, UV, or ozone by adding gaseous chlorine to the water or UV light or ozone bubbles into the water. This helps to destroy bacteria, viruses, and microorganisms in the water. Step 2 of the water treatment process is coagulation and flocculation. Chemicals with a positive charge are added to the water. The positive charge of these chemicals neutralizes the negative charge of dirt and other dissolved particles in the water. When this occurs, the particles bind with the chemicals and form larger particles called floc. To encourage increased floc production, a gentle mixing is utilized. Coagulant can be polyaluminum chloride, aluminum sulfate, or ferric sulfate. For example, with aluminum sulfate, if you add lime or calcium oxide, the reaction will form aluminum hydroxide as shown in this chemical reaction. This is a sticky gel, the aluminum hydroxide is a sticky gel that traps the finely suspended particles as illustrated in the figure. Step number 3 is sedimentation. During sedimentation, floc settles to the bottom of the water supply due to its weight. This settling process is called sedimentation. In this step, water and floc flow into a sedimentation basin that are 12 to 18 feet deep and hold water for a set time. Gravity and time are needed to remove the floc from the water. The fourth step is filtration. Once the floc has settled to the bottom of the water supply, The clear water on top, we pass through filters of varying pore sizes and compositions in order to remove remaining suspended particles such as dust, parasites, bacteria, viruses, and chemicals, as well as unsettled flocs. Two major types of filtration mechanisms are in operation. One is sand filtration, composed of coarse sand, gravel, and activated carbon or coal. And number two is membrane filtration. In the diagram that follows, you can see different membrane filtration processes and what they can be used for. The fifth step is disinfection. After water has been filtered, a disinfectant may be added in order to kill any remaining parasites, bacteria, viruses, and to protect the water from germs when it is piped to homes and businesses. Chlorine, ozone, and or UV light, all three may be used as disinfectant for water treatment. Unlike chlorine, however, UV or ozone is not as effective in the water distribution, is not effective in the water distribution system since they don't have residual disinfection effect. Chlorine has four key attributes. One, effectively inactivates a wide range of pathogens commonly found in water. Two, leaves a residual in the water that is easily measured and controlled. Three, is economical. And four, has an extensive track record of successful use in improved water treatment operations. It is very important to ensure adequate contact time for chlorination, chlorination is available before water enters the distribution system. The time taken for different types of microbes to be killed or inactivated varies widely, and typically 30 minutes is the target. Protozoa cysts are very resistant and require most exposure to chlorine. Chlorine demand, it's extremely important in water treatment. Essentially, dirty water contains high concentration of organic and inorganic material. Thus, dirty water will have higher chlorine demand and require a higher chlorine dosage. Clean water, on the other hand, has low chlorine demand. Residual chlorine or free available chlorine is chlorine remaining after the chlorine demand has been satisfied and disinfection has taken place. It is a critically important water quality parameter for public health. Presence of residual chlorine indicates that disinfection has occurred and the disinfected water has a degree of residual protection from microbial decontamination during storage and distribution. However, can you have too much chlorine? As we just mentioned, more contact time with chlorine is needed to inactivate certain microorganisms. In addition, chlorine forms disinfection byproducts, or DBPs, such as chloroform, trichloroacetic acid, which are harmful. Thus, chlorine must also meet drinking water quality standards. Too much chlorine can cause irritation to the eyes and nose, as well as stomach discomfort. Step number six is a supplemental treatment. Even after this purification has been done, some ions still remain in the water. These ions are not harmful but can cause annoyances, such as making cleaning more difficult or staining cookware. This type of water is known as hard water and mostly contains calcium, magnesium, iron in an aqueous forms. In order to remove these ions, sodium chloride or potassium chloride is added to the water and trades places with the other hard ions. This treated water is now known as soft water and usually has higher salt content than hard water. In large municipalities, fluoride can be added, which promotes dental health. To do this, a 24% fluorosilicic acid solution may be added. Ion exchange can also be part of the supplemental treatment to remove additional dissolved contaminants such as arsenic, chromium, excess fluoride, nitrates, radium, and uranium. The final step is storage. The treated water is pumped out of the plant and into the municipal water pipes through hundreds of miles of pipes. All of these pipes are potential sites for cross-contamination. Thus, it is important for water to contain residual chlorine for continued disinfection. And in here you can see the beautiful water storage towers in South Carolina, as well as in the Kuwait, in the city of Kuwait, the Kuwait towers. All right, so let's do some quick concept checks. Which of the following can be used for disinfecting water? That's correct. All of the above, chlorine, ozone, and UV, all can be used for disinfecting water. Another one, sand and gravel can be used for water filtration. That's true. As part of the water filtration process, sand, gravel, and as well as activated carbon is used to remove suspended particles. Another one, which of the following can be used for disinfecting water after the treated water has left the treatment plant? A, only chlorine. Ozone and UV do not have residual disinfection capability, only chlorine does. All right,